Love that. Hey, yes. Welcome back to Sister Circle Live. We can all use a little spiritual guidance from time to time. Today we have a special guest here for a segment called Ask the Pastor.
Yes.
We asked our viewers to send in some questions just for you.
And for the answers, who better to invite down to the circle but my very own pastor, Pastor E. Dewey Smith Jr.
Yes.
ATL, welcome to the show.
Yes. Thank you for having me.
This is a big deal right here.
Oh, my God.
Awesome job. Awesome.
Thank you. Pastor Dewey, you are known all over the world, but for just people that don't know who you are, can you just give us a little history of who you are and your in our church?
I'm a country boy from Macon, Georgia. Come on. Loves people, love to laugh, love to inspire people, love to bring people hope. And just honored to serve. So that's why I'm a servant.
And we are so glad you are here.
Thank you.
Pastor, we would be remiss if we didn't ask about Pittsburgh and what is currently going on in our nation. The uprising of hate crimes. Mm-hmm. You know, not just first, but we saw it in South Carolina when the guy went into the church and attacked the people, and now into a synagogue.
Right.
What do you think is happening? How can you communicate this spiritually to people?
Well, you know, that's a great question, but I think we have to really, really understand this is not new.
Mm-hmm.
Particularly for African Americans, we experienced it with the KKK and burning crosses in churches.
Yeah.
It's gone on for years. It's just a resurgence. And I think what's happened in the White House now has just put a mirror in the face of America to show us that we've not really overcome.
Mm.
And there are some powers that be that still are about racism, sexism, xenophobia, and hatred. And that's why we have to get to the polls and cast our votes to get that type of spirit out of office, because hatred is on the rise in the world. And it's sad when people can survive the Holocaust. A 97-year-old lady survived the Holocaust and got killed here in America.
Yes.
Right. So something's problematic with that. And I think it has something to do with who's in the White House.
Absolutely.
So we got to vote for it.
How are faiths coming together, though, as one to try to combat the divisiveness?
Well, we have to be more effective in doing that. Sometimes people want to perpetuate the empire. And sometimes for some people, color of the skin is what matters.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of hatred and there's a lot of fear, I believe, because America's becoming darker. Mm-hmm. And I think that fear has caused people to want to hold on.
Mm-hmm.
This is our country, take our country back. Sometimes those are dog whistles for it's getting too diverse.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's incumbent upon the faith community to come together regardless of ideology of philosophical presuppositions and work together to bring love. Love conquers all things.
I know that's right.
That's right.
Amen. All right, we're going to take a turn here, you know, because we did ask our viewers to send in some good stuff.
Yeah,
and it's going to get good.
Let's see.
Here's from Ava 211. My man has cheated on me 2 times, and I forgave him both times.
Lord have mercy.
But in my heart, things just ain't right. How many times is too many times to forgive someone, and how do you know when to just be done?
Well, first of all, the forgiveness can't be for the person.
Mm.
That forgiveness has to be for you.
Right.
So, Ava, you can't allow your lack of forgiveness. You not forgiving him is like you drinking poison and expecting him to die.
Mm.
So forgiveness is not for him, it's for you. Secondly, I think just because you forgive, that doesn't mean you reinstate the position.
Mm.
Come on, wait a minute.
Message.
Reinstate the position?
I do think that men sometimes we tend to mature at a much slower pace than women.
Snail's pace.
Somebody's preaching over here to me. All right? And we do, it's unfortunate, you know. Sometimes we do, and I think, but you can forgive, and sometimes you can move beyond that, but you have some reconciled questions and some unreconciled questions. Get answers, find out why, when, how, and then establish some non-negotiables.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we're gonna do this again, here are my non-negotiables. And sometimes when you break up, you can miss that person to reconnect. But it's not necessarily you missing them, it's you missing the idea of them.
Yeah.
So don't allow missing the idea of them to cause you to reconnect.
Ooh, that's why they call you the pastor.
Come on.
That's why they do it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to roll on right here with this one. And this one's from TJ's mother.
Yeah, okay.
It's TJ Mama. That's what it said. TJ Mama.
All right.
Now, she's asking the question. She says, how do you know when you found the one? She said, I've heard friends say that they knew right away.
Yeah.
Okay, she said, that's never happened to me. She said, how will I know when I've met my soulmate? What are the signs I look for?
That's a great question. One of my therapists said to me, instead of asking yourself, who is the one. The question is, how do you know you're the one?
How about that?
You know, because often we're trying to find the one, but how do you know you're the one? Mm-hmm. And when you recognize that you're the one, the attributes and characteristics that you think make you the one, then could be used as your litmus test for that one to become.
Ooh, yes, come on, litmus test.
I think the other piece too is that when you meet the one, it's not going to bring drama, stress, the fruit of spirit to bring peace,
woman,
joy. And then meeting the one will help you to get closer to the one.
I think it's important that you find
the ability to find peace and joy. Nobody needs to be anything that's dramatic and stressful.
I know
if
that's
it does
right.
If it does not add value to your life, you don't need it.
You sure don't.
Take it with you.
These little golden nuggets, joy.
All right, I have one from at Rachel Jones,
yeah,
21.
Rachel.
Hopefully she's not only 21 asking these kind of questions.
Let's go, Rachel.
It can be really hard when you're single.
Yeah.
Men today don't really have to do anything to pursue women because women are out there pursuing the men.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to chase a man, so how do I meet one? Sitting back just ain't gonna cut it.
Well, you know, that's a great question. In the church, we've taught women that he that finds a wife finds
a good thing.
So the sister has the Bible in hand, just waiting for the man to find you. But I think it's okay. Are you in a position to be found? First of all, do you go where men are?
Well, what a hang out at, Pastor.
I mean, football games, hardware stores. I mean, if you don't.
Hardware stores.
That's right.
Yeah, that's at Home Depot.
They're
handy.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
They can change a light bulb.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But what's up with this? You know, it's hard to chase a man. What's up with going up to a guy on the job, say, hey, my name is such and such, let's get a cup of coffee. I mean, what's wrong with making yourself presentable?
I want to talk about
not being thirsty, but what's up with, hey, I'm new. You're new here, and I want you to know who I am. Let's go out and hang out sometime. What's wrong with that?
But what if, see, sometimes when I like when the man. When the men do the choosing, and I'll tell you why.
Yeah.
Because I know that I am what they like.
All right.
You mess around and go over there and tell me, can I take you for coffee? He like, I like light-skinned women. You too skinny for me. I need something a little thicker. You know, I might not be what you want.
But going to coffee doesn't mean I'm trying to date you. It just means I want to have an opportunity to get to know you.
Go
I
to
think
coffee.
So, sometimes, yeah. I mean going to coffee, going to Starbucks does not mean I'm trying to take you to the bedroom. My goodness. So I think so it goes both ways. Nothing is wrong with a young lady introducing herself to a young man. That's my opinion. I may get shot for it, but that's my opinion.
And
do we ever
really know what we want?
Yeah.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
You
might
not want to until you get to him.
I would hope so.
Okay, well, we got another one.
Okay.
And it says at JJ7654.
Let's go, JJ.
Okay, JJ, say, look here. It seems like a lot of men shy away from marriage.
Yeah. Mm.
For many, it's the last thing they want to do. Why do some men see marriage as such a negative thing?
Well, I mean, let's be honest. Many of us didn't see good paradigms for marriage.
Yeah.
You know, on both sides of my family, if I wanted to say I want to be married, look at my family's dad. There's no marriage in my family that I want to emulate.
Mm.
Parents divorced, grandparents miserable, you know, aunts and uncles. So why would I want to be married if all I seen was hell and drama? So I think that's why it's important that, you know, some people are shying away from it because they're afraid of it, they're afraid of commitment.
Mm-hmm.
Some are afraid of getting involved in something and not working. But I believe that you just have to be what you want to be. And understand that it all works together, and God will send you. Be what you want to be, and be what you expect to be, and expect God to send you what you desire.
Wow.
And it'll work out. Add value to people's lives.
Right.
I'm coming to your church.
Like
I think we need to come on Sunday.
Yes.
We need to come on Sunday.
We'll set the table up and let you guys do a show
right
from the church. From the sanctuary.
Right. Pastor E. Dewey Smith of House of Hope, Atlanta. Let's give it up for him one more time. You are looking for a church in Atlanta. You can get a word at the House of Hope located in my hometown of Decatur, Georgia.
That's right.
You can also check out the amazing ministries there online at houseofhopeatl.org.